Good morning, everybody. My name is Marita. Welcome to the Jellyfish talk today, and it's about the discover the power of experiments and lifts in DV360. So we'll discuss the experiments and lifts in DV360. So a little bit about me. My name is Marita Fullinck. I am the director of training in Programmatic in the Google Marketing Platform. So this is basically what I do for a living here at Jellyfish. I teach people about the Google Marketing Platform and everything Programmatic. So today I decided to do this so that we can talk a little bit about what are experiments and lifts in DV360. How do you set up and what are the minimum spend requirements to do an experiment or a lift in DV360? How do you get insights such as brand lift surveys on reporting and optimization of Trueview, also known as YouTube campaigns? And then in the end, we're going to have a Q&A session where we'll ask questions and we'll discuss. So if you do have a question that pops up, you can type it in on the chat, but I will definitely look at it towards the end when we have the Q&A session. Okay, so let's start with the first question, which is, what are experiments and lifts? So when I talk about it, what do I mean by mentioning, you know, what are they? So as we already know, an experiment helps identify the causal impact of a certain change in advertising strategy, you know, what it has given on a success metric. So any change. So if I change A, what would be the result? You know, would it have resulted in B? So this is what we usually call A-B testing, but in reality is a placebo test. If we were thinking about science and talking about that, that's what they call it. So what are, how do we measure the effectiveness of our campaigns? So usually we do, we go for a cost per acquisition, meaning, you know, how our conversion rate or click-through rate. So these are the most common metrics, or we go by attribution data. So is it last touch, last, you know, fractional attribution or data driven? There's many options that we can choose from. And another of the, you know, success metrics that we look at is contextual KPIs, essentially metrics that indicate the health of our delivery. Was the campaign viewable? What are view through rates? Was our brand safe? Did we have enough reach and so forth? So this is just usually what we use as measuring the effectiveness of the campaign. Now, this is really, really basic, and I think everybody understands this, but it's fair to review what are the principles of an experiment. So there's five principles. Number one, the first step is we have to define the hypothesis. So what are we trying to prove? So it could be something, you know, an audience is better than another, using a search campaign is better than using display or video or YouTube, etc. Then we have to think about how we actually going to design this experiment. So what are the components of the experiment, how are we going to do it, the dates, what sort of creative we're going to use, and so forth. So once we have that, we have a very clear and concise design of what we're doing, we execute the experiment. So we make it, you know, we make it happen. So we put every, you know, we run the campaigns, we optimize, we do whatever changes we initially designed, and then we analyze the results. So once we analyze the results, we have a look at what happened, what was good, what was bad, and we take action based on those learnings. So we take actions, whichever action is needed, whether it is revisiting the hypothesis, revisiting the design, or we completely prove something with this particular experiment. So those are the very, very basic five steps, which I'm sure you probably already knew, but I wanted to refresh so that we can get all together in the mentality of what is an experiment and what are the five key steps that we need to take. One of the most common experiments out there in advertising that we do usually is the audience split experiment. And this is what we usually call the PSA, public service announcement. Don't panic. So it's basically what others call the charity test. So we use, the method is, we're going to discuss the method, the benefits, the disadvantages, and who the ideal candidate is. This is good to know when you're thinking about your clients or if you're managing a brand yourself. Is it really good for me? So basically in this methodology, we use a randomized segmentation. So we use the ad server. In this case, if we have the Google Marketing Platform, we would use Campaign Manager. And what we do is we divide our audience between two segments and apply the same treatment to both groups. So one group will serve our brand creative and the other group will serve the public service announcement ad, which could be the charity ad. So usually it could be an NGO or a different brand. So what we do is the benefits of this is that we have a clean separation in the segmentation and we know which creative was served and we can basically do analysis on the differences of both. So we spend the budget serving with the charity tests or the public service announcements, and we depend on cookies and device IDs. That's basically a disadvantage of it. Now, the ideal candidate for this type of test uses Campaign Manager. So this is something you can suggest to your clients or something that you can try. And you can do audience segmentation from the ad server. So not on the DSP, just from the ad server. And it has large budgets. So usually it's not conducted with a campaign that has really minimal budgets. It's conducted with a campaign that has, so let's say, a fair amount of spend. So the percentage of total spending is actually split to the PSA or the charity test. And you basically, before that, you would have, or the client would have, a partnership with an NGO or a brand that is not a direct competitor to get the most out of the comparison and that nothing is contaminated, if that makes sense. So this is what we call usually, oh, we're running a charity test. This is what they mean. So maybe you've heard about it before, but this is what we call the audience split test. So why do we do it? We basically separate the target audience. Okay, we set up groups, as I mentioned, so that you have two different settings or it's the same targeting, but something changes. In this case, it would be the creative. You compare the performance of each group, and then the results are used for the media or marketing decision making. So very, very simple. This is the historically what we've usually have done and what we can still do. So this is one of the first tests that we do. So now if we look at this here, I'm going to use my little pointer. This is the journey of how you actually do the audience split test. And this is an example. So you choose your strategy, whether it's prospecting or targeting. You choose your control group. Okay, it could be a test group, could be randomly assigned. And then you serve the impression. It could be the public service announcement or charity creative. And then you have the control prospects. So then you compare the conversions. So you choose your strategy. You use Campaign Manager for the segmentation, for the split. And then the ads are shown on the control group and those of the brand test group. So you can see that both ads are shown. And the conversion data is tracked for both groups, the test and the control group. And then you calculate conversion rate lift. So that's what it is essentially. A little bit complex, this graph, but I like to visualize it. Some of us learn by seeing. So another way of doing this particular test, just as an example, let's imagine our client is our luxury travel agency. And this luxury travel agency, our client, they really want to see, hey, let's do a site uplift test. So the main KPI of this luxury travel client is to drive site uplift. And what we do is, hey, let's work with publishers that can pass back cookie IDs, device IDs, so that we can see what has happened in terms of conversions. So you set up your exposed audience, which only sees your luxury travel banners. And then in order to ensure that Campaign Manager can segment the user into each audience bucket, you use the user's cookie. So you use device IDs, which need to be passed back in the ad request. And this is why we specifically work with publishers that are able to do that. And this is how we do it in Campaign Manager. So you test the landing page using the two audience segmentation, and you use the cost per unique incremental visitor as a metric goal. And basically, you create one group of audience segment one and two, and you split the weighting between these two evenly. This is some of the settings and things that you can do in Campaign Manager. And this is some of the one example of how you would do the audience split test straight from the ad server, which is Campaign Manager. Okay, so this is example number one. So in this session, I'm going to just review some of them. What are the things that you can do to give you some ideas for your clients and so forth? So how do you calculate incrementality? So how would I know? This is really a little bit of a complex formula, but don't worry. All it does is it uses what increase did the group A have one better increment in terms of conversions than group A, and so forth. So it's based purely on the incremental ratio at which a user converts. Let's say if they've seen a regular display ad versus the public service announcement ad or charity test. And let's say in this example, for example, let's suppose that 0.8% of the users in the control group and 1.2% of the users in the test group did a lead, okay, using data-driven attribution and during the study period. So the associated lift would be this particular formula. So you apply the percentage of the lift to calculate the incremental conversions achieved based on the different levels of spend. So we would need to spend a little bit more time on that as when you do your calculations, but thankfully we have a great usually analytics team who has a look at this type of stuff. But the other type of test that we can do is the very simple A-B testing. It's one of that we're very familiar with. Okay. And this A-B testing basically uses the method of segmentation. So you still divide your audience in two segments, but you apply the same treatment to both groups. So there's no changes. In the other one, we had two different creatives. This one has the same. You have a clean user separation, and it is done in real time of the bidding. So for example, a user has this particular criteria and the other doesn't. And there's some disadvantages. So there may be bias that we don't optimize both groups in exactly the same way. And we also depend on cookies and device IDs. So we could optimize one audience in one way and another in a different way because they're different. We're optimizing both groups separately. So the ideal candidate has two simple and comparable variables. They're using potentially different creatives, potentially also different formats and different bid strategies. So right now I'm speaking very programmatically heavy because this is a training that's specifically for programmatic traders and people in that have or are managing this type of display and video campaigns. Later we'll talk a little bit about branding. So let's imagine here in this particular graph, you can see all of the things that we can test. But here I'm just focused on audiences. Okay, so if we're using the Google Marketing Platform, specifically DV360, you can compare your Google audiences, Google data, demographics, affinity, against first-party audiences, against third-party audiences, and you can do all sorts of different targeting. But where I'm going to focus just on this, and let's imagine the client or our brand, we weren't sure if similar audiences would work the same as first-party audiences, and we wanted to test that. Okay, so we are going to go ahead and do that, and let's imagine we do that, and we set it up in DV360. This is a screenshot of what the platform looks like. So it would be in the system, the DSP, it would be in the experiments and lift section, and I'm going to explain what each of these numbers now mean. So we essentially are comparing one line item with the other side by side, and we can see here on the, you know, on the right, if there's been an uplift, an increase, so we don't have to rely on that complicated formula I showed you at first. The system really does it for us already. Okay, so let's have a look at how that works. So you can do things, like I mentioned, such as advanced audience testing. In this case here, I have a custom affinity group, which is the baseline compared to the variant one. Things that I can do. So what's this experiment about? I can evaluate my CPM. Is this one cheaper than the other, or is it more, you know, statistically significant? I can compare bid strategies. I can test the different audiences, and I can prove out a new optimization tactic. So I can say, hey, this really works really well, or no, this is not working very well. But the advantage of it is that I can test the learnings a step further and decouple audience, you know, learnings from media or contextual learnings through audience segment testing. So I'm not, you know, giving ideas or throwing I thinks, is I'm giving really specific numbers of why something works better than the other. So we're being very specific. We see any changes with numbers. So rather than just, I think this really works well. So sometimes a client is, or you yourself are unsure of a strategy, you can really test it. So you can use the DV360 A-B testing framework to evaluate all of these different criterias and be able to provide a statistically significant, suggestion, or separate line items or insertion orders with specific goals and provide that specific suggestion with high confidence levels. So you say, look, I'm really 95% confident that this works best. So now what sort of experiment can I do on audiences? So focusing on the example of a luxury travel client, let's say you can test things like audiences who have previously booked vacation rentals, are they more profitable than audiences who have booked guest houses, what are bed and breakfast, for example? Audiences who have previously visited a home or luxury, someone who's interested in luxury, are they more profitable than a leisure, than somebody who travels for leisure or somebody who travels domestically, or people who've booked any accommodation type of groups of sizes of three or plus? These are the types of insights that are, you know, a specific client, like a luxury travel client, will be interested in. So not only are they targeting travelers, but they also want to have a little bit more detail on their different target audiences and who has, you know, a better, the type of behaviors they have, who engages more with the ads, and so forth. So these are some of the hypotheses that you can create. And this is why I speak about designing the experiment before actually executing it, so that everybody is 100% clear of what the hypothesis is, of what you're testing, what you're fishing for, and which changes and dates you need to make as the campaign is live. Okay? So examples, for you would select your research goal, like I mentioned. You set your significance level in platform, so it would be something here. Okay? And then you compare which line item, in this case, my business affinity with my brand, custom affinity, and you can see the difference or split the audience. And here I've split it 50-50. And then that's how I'm going to set up the experiment in the system. So very, very simple once the campaign is set up. Now, the question is, all right, Marita, great. I can do tests. But how do I know which tool is most suitable for which experiment? So for example, there's two things. You can test for optimization, so to understand which tactic is better in terms of, is my optimization strategy the best one? Or you can test for incrementality, meaning is there a lift in conversions if I change this or that? So when you're doing optimizations for search and display, you want to do your measurement. You can be draft and experiments. For videos, you can use experiments and lifts, brand lifts for any video, any YouTube campaign KPIs, for example, and you can use A/B testing tools comparisons. For incrementality, let's say if you're doing YouTube and Trueview, you can think about ad recall, awareness, favorability, consideration, and purchase intent, which I'll speak about a little bit more later on. But this is what we, when I say brand lift, this is what I mean. And then conversion lift, clearly, I just mean conversions and sales. So there's two different type of tools you can use for optimization. So which optimization technique is better, or the other one, which is incrementality. So you can have a look at, for branding or for performance, which of these tools would I use? And now I'm going to go into all of the different ones that you can do. So you can choose your goal, your metric. In the platform, you would add the dates. You select the significance and the participants. So which campaigns, which line items. So very simple to set up in platform. So I know not all of you are traders, but this is essentially what the trader does when they're in the DSP. They select the goals. So this is how they do it. They basically choose, they put the name of the experiment. They choose what are they comparing, insertion orders or line items, the start dates, because this would be this would have been already decided when you're designing or thinking about what to test. And then you measure the research goal. So what are you testing? Is it clicks, conversions, or video completions? So then you select your confidence interval. So is basically how confident are you that this is correct? And you would consider a significant difference in the results. So based on AB, what is a significant difference of the results? Is it 90 or 95%? What would you rather? And then you choose the experiments type that you can decide to run the experiment. So are you choosing insertion orders? Insertion orders usually have different targeting criterias, or do you have different line items, or are you comparing two campaigns or two different groups? So we strongly recommend to build out the desired setup and just basically duplicate the campaign so that it's 100% similar, that there's no human error, and that you change the feature or the test variable. So it could be either the bidding strategy, the creative, whatever it is, but make sure that they're 100% identical so that it's a fair test and that it does have significance. So this is what it would look like in the system. If you look at my screenshot here on the right, You change the audience split if needed. If you can split it by 50 or 20%, you can, you know, you can do whatever you'd like to do. And you have a maximum of 10 variants that can be tested. So I'll speak about those variants. It could be the targeting criteria, it could be the audience, day parting, whichever behavioral or maybe bidding strategy that you'd like to test, you can do that here. So this is why it's super important that you think before you come into platform of what test you'd like to do. Okay, so this is what the final product would look like. So you have, there's a 95% chance in this result that manual bidding gets 77.5% fewer conversions than the automated bidding. So you can see them, the comparison side by side. That's what you would see in the system. And it would tell you the experiment date and the confidence interval. So this, out of this, you can set up your reports and you can show, you know, your client the statistics, and you speak with numbers rather than opinions, which I love. I love to speak with numbers. Now, the next part of the session is more for branding campaigns. So what is brand lift? So if you're in the boom, you would like to create a big bang of a product, or you want to let everybody know so that then you can, you know, retarget and do conversions. Let's talk about how we can do that. So that's more on the YouTube side of things. So it lets you measure the metric that matters with results you can trust. So metrics that matter would be ad recall, brand awareness, brand interest, consideration, favorability, and purchase intent. So it's, you use the methodology, so the Google best in class methodology, of the hold down methodology as well. You have a control group and a test group. And what the cool thing about this is that you can test, you can improve the effectiveness of your campaign in real time. So you don't have to wait till the campaign is over, like the previous lift. You can actually do it as the campaign is going and going, which I did often when I was running lots of awareness campaigns. And I gather insight for any future media planning, but also in real time. This is what I love about this. And let's talk about how we can do it. If anybody has seen any of these YouTube surveys, I always do. And I try to complete them, but just because I'm competitive, and I'm like, yeah, I got the answer. But basically, this is what a brand study is. There's a couple of questions. They tell you, hey, have you seen this video? I usually feel like they're testing my memory. I'm like, oh, did I really or did I not? And I'm, you know, it's like a trick question. The bad part about this is I never get the right answer. So, but, you know, on the other side, I do. So let me show you what type of questions these are. So how do we build these questions? Maybe you guys have already ran these tests already. If you haven't, this is something that brand managers love. So please do recommend it to your clients. Or if you are a client yourself, make sure that you do, you know, test this. So the way that it works is that the user watches the video, they complete the survey, and then brand lift is measured. There's different things that can be measured. So you have awareness, which is where we do ad recall, how well that they remember the ad, are they aware of our brand? Then you have consideration. I'll speak about each of these in a little bit more detail, but they're essentially four categories, and they're available for Trueview campaigns. Now, a lot of these things, there's a lot of releases that are going to happen this quarter, the end of this quarter for DV360. So a lot of the things in the user interface are on beta. So there's a lot of beta testing that people can do. So if your client is keen on testing new things or trying new experiments, specifically now when people are being more cautious with their advertising investment, this is something that you can basically recommend. And this is how it works. Okay, so you get your ad recall highlights. For example, you can check the progress and results at the end of the campaign, or at the end of the study, you get something like this, which is a report. Eventually, I think we're going to be able to check this in platform, but at the moment, you mostly everybody gets it like this. I know that we have, you can sign up to a beta and get different access, but you can see, for example, which demographic, in this case, is Mercedes-Benz. They had a uplift with females, 37%, and they can see which demographic was the best in class, and they can see how many impressions provided a lift. So you can actually change your targeting. You can see in this one, the result, the desktop is 98% lift, and it gives you some recommendations. Now, this happens right before the campaign ends. So this is not done after the campaign is over. This is done in real time. So after the, I think, the 7 days or whichever period you set up, you will get this result before your campaign ends. So you can make adjustments and changes. Now, one cool thing about this as well is actually the benchmarks are calculated based on other studies of people or brands in the same category. So this, in this example, is the automotive vertical. Okay, so you're compared with others. So there's a couple of considerations before we move on to explaining the details. So a couple of limitations. So experiments cannot be run in the following types of inventory. I feel like I need to tell you, right? You cannot run experiments in lifting programmatic guaranteed default line items or insertion orders with default line items. So at the moment, this is on beta. It may change, remember. Trueview line items, you're not able to do the experiment in lift specifically, but this is, I think, in the works. A line item or insertion order can only be used in a single active experiment at a given time. So you can't use one line item for 20 different experiments. You can only use it one. And you can adjust the audience split percentages after an experiment starts. So this is the importance of designing it, because if you design, you know, you can't change a 50-50 split after it started. You need to know 100% what you want. So it's key to design it. So another limitation is that in most cases, we serve the ads just to new users to make sure that the A/B test is valid and there's no contamination. And in the case that two campaigns are running simultaneously in the same market, we also make sure that they're mutually excluded to avoid contamination. So you need to make sure that if you're comparing two campaigns, that the same user is not exposed to both, that if you've been exposed to this, you're not exposed to that. Very, very clear. And then volumes. So a limitation is that if your client doesn't have huge volumes in terms of an audience or similar audience, that this is going to restrict the availability of impressions. So this is key to ensure when you're designing your experiment that your audience groups are big enough and that there's no imbalance on which audience you're testing with the other, because this will affect the bid price and the performance of the audience. And then there's a lot of uncontrollable factors. So no two ad impressions can ever be the same. So only the methodology by which we target, that's the only thing that can be the same. So whilst our test minimizes the difference, even though we set it up equally, there are also independent variables that always will exist. So we need to have a large statistical significance to be confident of our results. And that's why we put it to 90-95% to make sure that it's not a maybe, that it's 100% so. And lastly, there's variances in products, services, and in the retargeting prospects. So if users in the retargeting cookie pools may be viewing different products or services, they could be skewed or influenced by different factors that we can't control. And then there's also the selection bias. There's a high propensity audiences may already want to buy the product. So they could be, they already may be in the mindset to buy the product without necessarily being retargeted. So in order to test this bias, we need to exclude a random subset of high propensity audiences to test incrementality. So if this is something you want to do, you can also design it that way. Now, as you can see, those are things that need to be discussed so that they're not a surprise at the end or when you're running the experiment, so you don't change it. Now, there's another limitation or consideration that you must take into account when thinking about these particular experiments is the minimum spend for video campaigns. So one question to three questions varies across the board, and this actually changes by country. So if you're in the UK, in the US, or in any other region in South Africa, for example, there's different amounts that would need to be spent. So this is in US dollars, but yes, I highly recommend that you speak to your client, but as you can see, they're not small amounts. So yes, the reason for this is you need a minimum amount of impressions in order for you to test significance. So these are some of the considerations to think about. Now, moving on to best practices, let's talk about what are the cool things that you can do. So I'm going to keep it really simple. If we were to do like a longer training, of course, we would speak in detail about this, but we only have a couple of minutes. Best practice is to check that the data is clean and as unbiased as possible. So let's say you were using, you have a client and it's a banking client and you're doing an experiment. There is already some sort of bias. For example, you're selling a credit card. You're targeting people people with a higher credit score. That's what I mean by bias. The bias is that you already have a predetermined mindset of who you actually want to target. So you want to make sure the data is clean and as unbiased as possible. Okay. Now the KPI needs to be measured clearly. And then the metrics cannot be changed mid-test. I think we already know this, but it's good to mention to the clients and to remind yourselves that you can't, even though something seems like a good idea, you can't actually change it in the middle of the test. And now the next part is you make sure that your groups are not being cross-exposed or contaminated, because then it's not going to be a fair result. This person was exposed two or three times to the ad. Therefore, is it really fair? Not sure. The samples have to be random to help avoid bias, like I mentioned. And you also need to not bias the tests with changes in strategy or tactics in other channels, for example, in search. So, you know, if you're testing search and display, but then another one, you learn something from the display campaign and then it's changed in, this, in the search, that wouldn't be a fair test. So you wait till the end of duration, the end of the experiment duration or the dates, and then you can make changes. So one very, very big tip, which I think should be obvious, but it's not, is that to maximize communication in the teams. You in an experiment, you have different teams involved. You have search teams, analytics teams, media buying teams, media planners, and branding teams. So you need to have a kickoff call, communicate how you've designed the test, the logic behind everything, the dates of changes. Everything needs to be 100% clear, because if somebody somewhere drops the ball, the experiment will fail. And this is often why some experiments and budgets are removed from testing, because things just never were conclusive or people messed up during the setup. So make sure that everybody's aligned so that you can have meaningful test results. So, of course, make sure that there's a big budget or enough, a big enough budget that you can run a test with. The results are magnificent. Brand managers, based on my experience so far, love it. And you avoid testing too many things at once. Okay, so let's have a look. So basically, these are the type of questions that you would ask when it comes to brand lift studies. Okay, so you have your campaign goal awareness, so in yellow, ad recall, brand awareness, in green, brand interest, consideration, and favorability, and finally, the action purchase intent. So you use it, for example, in awareness when you have a brand or product launch, or an action is, you know, no call to action is needed. So you want to know basically what is the impact of your brand campaign, or, you know, the awareness of the product. Brand interest is, for example, you want to know consideration and favorability and purchase intent. So these are the type of questions. So if you look at the left, this is the type of questions. This is what I wanted to show you. Which of the following have you seen an online video for advertising recently? So this is to basically find out how effective your creative is, to gain insights on the audience, or get actionable insights. So it's essentially for branding, and it uses you for creatives that usually use humor, animation, and have a familiar tone. For awareness, you would ask something, which of the following have you heard of? So you can, when do you use this? You use it when you want to test as well, the impact of your brand, or, you know, are they remembering competitors instead of yourself? And here for search, so this is not based on surveys, but what we do is we measure organic search lift compared to the control group. So you do brand interest. I don't know if the search guys already have done this, but you basically find out how well your branding campaign is driving interest online. So you can see if people are organically searching more. Finally, some sort of consideration, which is when the goal is clearly moving consumers towards considering a specific product or a potential match. So it's not recommended for institutional or family brand campaigns. This is more for when you want to increase the consideration of your brand. And lastly, you have favorability. So which of these following brands would you have a positive opinion of? And the one that we like the most when we are in performance is the purchase intent. So which one, next time you buy a product, which one are you most likely to buy? So that's the purchase intent. So you evaluate whether your ad convinces people to buy your product or not, and you gain insights on your audience. So that's essentially what a brand lift study would do. You set up in the system, and then you can find the results here. Some of these you may not necessarily have seen before because it could be on beta, or you don't have it, but this is how you actually see the progress and results of your experiment in the system. So you can see which measure, if people have skipped your views, skipped your videos, or if you have videos, or what impression or frequency works best. And this, again, you see the results of your specific study. So that essentially is, there's a bit of a glossary. I'm not going to ask you to read that, but this is just some of the words that we use when we are talking about, how do you say, brand lifts and things. So the next question is, after you see that, is basically, all right, so how long should I test for? What is the ideal time frame? So essentially, remember, you need to make sure that you have a goal. So what's the main objective of the test? What are you trying to learn? You prepare for your timeline, you test, and you do subsequent analysis. We recommend 14 to 18 weeks, to be honest, from the start of the hypothesis, which would take you 1 or 2 weeks to think, oh, we want to test this. Then 1 or 2 weeks to test and design, a client approves it. You spend 6 to 8 weeks within the pretest and the testing, and then 2 weeks of analysis and 1 week of feedback. And that is your full period of testing. Now, the questions are, can we bear the cost? Is this campaign or budget significant enough for us to make this particular test? Do we have KPIs very clear? Are we testing for signups, purchases, or visits? And then we also want to ensure that the methodology is consistent throughout, with being able to interpret the results and being able to take concrete actions based on it. So this is what I mean by discovering the power of experiments and lifts. We need to ensure that we do things like this. And just out of, for those of you who are here who are traders, what are the pitfalls, for example, of some of the things that people do? One of the things that we recommend is, do not test mixed and fixed automated line items in one IO. Sounds like a tongue twister for those of you who are not in programmatic, but for those who are in platform trading, yes. So basically, people create two line items with the same targeting in one IO, with one set to fixed bid and the other set to automated bid. And so that's a no-no, because basically the algorithm of the, basically it's going to be computing, the bid of the algo is lower than the fixed bid, there'll be a high chance that the fixed bidding line item wins over the other algorithm, because it creates a bias. So don't create your own bias. Best practice is to make sure that there's no overlap in the inventory and that their line items are mutually exclusive and they're running official, and then you run an official A-B test. So that for me is the key learnings that I've, things that I've spoken about just now that we want to conclude is, you've had the similar audience comparison groups with public service announcement tests. You can match market with similar markets or cities. You can compare sort of things like that. You can use Campaign Manager. You can use audiences from Google Analytics 360 to push them into DV360, and then you can test them. We say the flight should be a minimum 30 days. The results can be reviewed periodically or in Data Studio in real time. And then you have test outputs such as conversion lift, allowing you to calculate incremental conversions, leads, site visits, creatives, or audiences. So this is essentially what I've spoken about. If you guys would like to know a little bit more about it, I'm happy to speak to you privately. If you have a client that is looking to test and or you want to prove out a hypothesis wrong or correct, this is the way of doing it. So do let me know if you want to speak about it. But yeah, this is a time for questions and answers now. I don't think I've seen any questions so far, but I'm happy for you to ask me anything now. In terms of tests that I've done, let's say I have run tests for YouTube, for example, where we had two creatives. We're running two creatives and you want to test which video is more effective. You can separate it in the line item and so forth. I had one video which was Cara Levine and one Naomi Campbell, and they wanted to see which one worked better. So we did that in real time. I wanted to see if there was a site uplift and so forth. So yeah, there's many, many different tests, but it's up to us to think about it, to design it with the client, and to find out what are the methods that we can do. So I'm going to send you a link for inspiration as well, if you'd like to read a little bit more about it, what Google has to say, think with Google on insights and experiments and lives. So time for your for you guys. Do you have any questions? Any questions for me? Can you please explain again why the difference between significance? Yes. So basically, you want to be 100%, well, not 100%, but 95% sure that this is better than the control line. So that it's like if me and Mia compete, she wants to be 95% higher, that I've had a conversions lift of 95% or higher. So that would be significant enough. So it wasn't an increase of 2%, 5%. It was 95% better than the original one. So that's what we call it significant enough. Okay? So you would have had to won by 95%. Wonderful. Any other questions? Cool. So if we don't have any more questions, that was experiments and lifts. In summary, you have the experiments and lifts that you can use in the UI, and finally brand lift studies that you can use with YouTube campaigns, etc. With the minimum thing timing recommendation of 30 days, is it possible to also set up to stop once a significant number of responses have been received? It is not possible, but usually the methodology with brand lift, the spend equals to the significance level, so it's in proportion. Very good question. But yes, it stops at that. So the minimum spend is, let's say, if the minimum spend is 7K, is because at that point is considered significance enough. Since YouTube brand lift study is based on the data Google has for that particular category, what happens if a new category comes up, but there's not enough data available? I think they already have set up categories. So what the Google account manager sets it up based on the category that's already existing. If it's a brand new category, I highly doubt that it would be on its own. Usually there's something where they would fit in. So it's very unlikely that they would have like a standalone category. They usually belong to FMCG, automotive, retail. There's always somebody already in the competitor categories. Awesome, guys. You've been wonderful. Hopefully this was of some sort of insights for you and that you learned something new. So that is all from me today. I'm going to stop presenting. And yeah, that's it. That's the power of experiments and lifts. You get insights in real time of your campaigns. You don't have to wait for them to be over. Thank you very much.